I'm Eric Parker this morning on CT21. We're not quite done with election 2021 as one of the most contested races goes to a recount today. We're revisiting the most interesting matchups and looking to the future with the chair people of Connecticut's Democratic Party and the GOP.
A diamond ring. I'm very happy to welcome to our show today for the first time a new group, a group that caused quite a stir New Year's Eve in our town of Hartford at the Bushnell.
And this past week, we lost a media legend. We're talking about the life and legacy of Connecticut radio giant Brad Davis with some of the people who knew him best. Plus, a turkey and a 30. The annual campaign is underway and more important this year than ever. Connecticut Food Chair President and CEO Jason Jakubowski is joining us in Studio A. It's all ahead this Sunday, November 7th. It's 8:30. Did you remember to set your clocks back? CT21 starts right now.
From Channel 3, this is Connecticut's most watched current affairs program, CT21, with Eric Parker, sponsored by Hartford Healthcare.
Good morning and thank you for being with us. The election hasn't been officially decided in West Haven. A tight race between incumbent Mayor Nancy Rossi and Republican challenger Barry Lee Cohen heads to a recount today. That race is one of several that drew voters to the polls in large numbers this off-election year. Here to talk about the races and what the outcomes might mean for the future are Connecticut's Democratic Party Chair Nancy Dinardo and GOP Chair Ben Proto. Thank you both for being with us. I want to start with that West Haven race. Obviously, a lot of eyes are watching that one. The recount's happening today. I'm sure both of you will be as well. Nancy?
Oh, yes, absolutely. But I'm confident that it will be Nancy Rossi at the end because 24 votes or 29 votes is a lot to make up. So I don't think we'll see any change there.
And Ben, from the Republican perspective, just to push it that far to a recount must sort of go with what you've been talking about over this past week, saying that Republicans turned out in big numbers.
Yeah, we were very excited in West Haven. Traditionally a very strong Democratic town. To be that close in the mayor's race, I think speaks volumes of where the Republican Party is moving and the campaign we ran there. So we're looking forward to see what the recount's gonna come out with today. I would probably agree with Nancy, 29 votes is a lot of votes to switch in a recount, but stranger things have happened.
Sticking with that theme, I wanna stick with you, Ben. One of the big headlines coming out of Election Day was the flips in some municipalities, the Republicans being very proud of many of those flips. From your perspective, was that the big takeaway?
In a lot of ways, yes. Towns like Bristol, where we hadn't won in a long time, Windsor Locks, there's not been a Republican leader there or a control of boards and commissions for over 20 years, East Granby, Portland, towns like that, particularly out east, we picked up a number of the smaller towns that have traditionally been with the Democratic Party. So we're very excited in having held Danbury in an open race without Mark Boughton for the first time in 20 years on the ballot. Aaron Stewart obviously is a superstar in New Britain for us. Holding Darien in Westport was the one we were watching closely with State Representative Jonathan Steinberg running for mayor, our first selectman actually, in Westport, a longtime state rep. And we were able to not only win that seat in a town that Joe Biden won 75-25 last year, but we won all the boards and commissions as well.
A lot, Nancy, I want to turn to you. A lot of what we heard from Republicans and people analyzing this was what Ben just said, that there were some good outcomes for Republicans. It sounded, though, like when you were looking at things, you don't know if that's necessarily to do with Republicans versus Democrats as opposed to the individual towns.
Well, I do believe that. I mean, we did have some pickups that we normally don't do. They weren't as many as the Republicans, granted, but you know, Avon, Coventry, and Enfield were clean sweeps for us. And then we did pick up on some boards that we hadn't before. So, we look at it as individual towns because municipalities tend to be small, and you focus on the issues that are in the town and the candidates in the town. It's not the same as when you're looking at a presidential.
Well, we will be looking not at a presidential, but we will be looking at some statewide elections coming up next year. Do you, as the chair of your party, worry that some of these towns that you lost in the municipal elections, that could be harbinger of bad things to come?
No, I don't see it that way. I mean, I'm always worried about elections, but I don't see that because, again, it's specific issues in the towns that usually make the difference in municipal elections. And, you know, quite honestly, I think the governor has done a great job. I mean, the polls are even showing that, you know, he has high favorability ratings. people are happy with how he handled COVID. Connecticut's one of the leading states as far as keeping COVID down. The rainy day fund is the highest it has ever been. And, you know, in spite of the fact that the Republicans, you know, 2 years ago tried to use it, you know, to pay off some, you know, budget expenses, which the governor firmly opposed. And, you know, he's just, we're fiscally, getting fiscally sound, and it's all due to Ned Lamont.
Ben, I want to ask you about the momentum piece of this. You've been outspoken saying, you know, listen, this is a good sign that many of these towns flipped. In his Sunday column today, Chris Powell from the Journal Inquirer says, that's great, Republicans, but wait till Trump returns to the national stage, and that may be something that here in Connecticut, your candidates have to run against. How do you see that as things move forward and maybe former President Trump is back on the national stage in a bigger way?
Well, in many towns, the local Democrats attempted to tie candidates, Republican candidates, to Donald Trump in the January 6th and failed miserably with it. What people tend to forget is Donald Trump isn't the president of the United States. Joe Biden is. We have $3.50 to $4 gallon gas because of Joe Biden. We have $3 plus gallons of milk because of Joe Biden. We have $4 dozen eggs because of Joe Biden. We have energy costs that are rising because of Joe Biden. At the end of the day, people are concerned about what's going on with them today. I understand what the Democrats would like to do, because when you have no accomplishments to really run on, you have to find a boogeyman. And they think Donald Trump is the boogeyman. They tried it this year and it didn't work. I don't think it's going to work again next year. I think people are going to be more concerned about what Joe Biden has done to the economy and to the country and to the world than what Donald Trump might or might not be saying.
Another thing that really didn't work largely this year was the fight against critical race theory. There were a number of candidates who came out and made that, especially for boards of education, their big topic. Ben, do you worry that, as we've seen that in the headlines across the country, that's it just didn't take traction? I mean, is that going to be a part of the Republican platform in 22?
I think the issue of critical race theory is somewhat overblown. I think the more important issue is parental rights and parental freedoms. And a lot of people want to point to Guilford and to, I believe it was Coventry, but don't talk about New Canaan or Cheshire or other towns where, for instance, in New Canaan, there was a caucus of almost 1,000 people in July where they removed the incumbent Board of Ed members and put in some candidates who were not as ardent as the Guilford folks, but talked a lot about critical race theory. They swept the Board of Education. Cheshire swept the Board of Education. I think the issue is more about parental rights and whether or not the government should be inserting itself between parents and their children.
We only have about a minute left. I want to have each of you tell me what you think for next year. Nancy, go first. What's the momentum going forward for the Democratic Party heading into 22?
Well, I think you'll see, we're looking at what happened this year. We're going to be talking about it. And I think you will see that we are going to make a complete change in deciding how we want to go forward. And it will make a difference. I'm very excited about next year's race. I see great victories all the way up and down the ballot.
And how about you, Ben? What's your prediction for 22?
I think the Republican Party has great momentum. We won the special election in the 36th district. We had a great night the other night, flipping over 24 towns. When you have gubernatorial candidates in other states saying, we don't want to beat Connecticut, I think that speaks volumes of where we're at and what's happening in the state of Connecticut. I see really good things happening for the Republican Party in the state of Connecticut once the Republican Party picks up additional seats, and I think has a very competitive gubernatorial race next year.
Well, I don't have to tell either of you, both pros at this. One election's over, that means the next one has begun.
Right. Absolutely.
Yes,
we'll hope
absolutely.
To see you both back here on CT22 next year.
Okay. Look forward to it. Thanks for having us.
Thank you both. Coming up, he was the voice of WDRC for more than 40 years, and for a time, he even worked here at Channel 3. Some familiar friends are about to enter the studio to talk about Brad Davis, who died this past week. We'll have that for you when we come back.